Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. We're at the end of page. We're at the page of N225. If you like this podcast, please tell all the people and rate and review. I want to see those reviews. You know, do that stuff. And subscribe. We're almost at episode 900, I think. I think it's just three episodes from now. And then when you get to 1,000, you might not have access to the old ones. And you got to start at the beginning. What else? If you want to email me, dictionarypod@gmail.com, you can say some stuff. You can say, hey, you made a mistake on this, which is probably a very common occurrence. You said something you shouldn't have. You did this thing and I just want to comment. Whatever. Whatever you want to say, that's fine. You can follow me on social media at dictionarypod. So if you listened to yesterday's episode, which obviously you did, you know, I was a little confused by the word cis, the prefix cis, and why didn't we see cisgender, and like, where was that in this whole thing, and how did the prefix cis get added to that? It's this whole new thing. So I went to this website, Etym Online, where you can look up, it's the online etymology dictionary. Go check it out if you want to know where words came from. So it says, it basically means not transgender, in general use by 2011. So I think this book, I don't know, maybe it just didn't get into the book until a little bit later. So it basically means cis, which means on this side of, and then the word gender, on this side of gender. What does that mean? I don't know. I think it just basically means like, this is the gender that I identify as. I am on this side of the gender that I was physically born as. So I don't know. I guess if you were confused about that phrase, that's basically what that means. I am on this side of this gender. It's a little confusing, but I guess when you think about it that way, it makes sense. So anyway, that's that. And if I had bought a newer book, maybe it would be in the book. It really should be in the book. If it's not in the dictionaries, like the physical dictionaries, then we got some problems. All right. Let's talk about the words in this episode. The first one is cist, C-I-S-T. I guess you could also say kist. Noun from 1804. A Neolithic or Bronze Age burial chamber typically lined with stone. W, is that Welsh? Let's see, Welsh or West or Western. It's probably Welsh. And that means chest. So it's a chest, a burial chamber. Yeah, I guess that makes sense. Next is Cistercian, capital C-I-S-T-E-R-C-I-A-N, Cistercian. Noun from 1611, a member of a monastic order founded by St. Robert of Molesme in 1098 at Citeaux, France, under Benedictine rule. Yep, that's good. Cistercian is also an adjective. Next is cistern, noun from the 13th century. One, an artificial reservoir, as an underground tank, for storing liquids and especially water, as rainwater. Number two, a large, usually silver vessel formerly used at the dining table. And the example at the dining table would be to in cooling wine. They used to use it to cool wine. Number three, a fluid containing sac or cavity in an organism. It's a cistern. It's just a thing to hold liquids. Let's see, this is from Latin, cisterna, from cista, which means box or chest, and there's more at the word chest. Next is cisterna, noun from circa 1860. Let's see. Okay, there's no numbers, so we just start right off with a number three definition for the word cistern, which is just the fluid containing sac or cavity in an organism. But then we have sub A and B. A says one of the large spaces under the arachnoid membrane, and B, one of the flattened vesicles comprising the Golgi apparatus and the part of the endoplasmic reticulum studded with ribosomes. When I think of things being studded, I think of like a studded bracelet, a studded choker, a studded, I don't know, something. But this is a part of, it's a part, it's an organ, it's a thing. I don't know. It's a lot of fancy words in this one. Cisternal is an adjective. Next is cistron, noun from 1957, a segment of DNA that is equivalent to a gene and that specifies a single functional unit as a protein or enzyme. And cistronic is an adjective. Next is the abbreviation CIT. Number one, citation or cited. And number two, citizen. Next is the word citadel. Citadel, noun from 1562. One, a fortress that commands a city. Two, the synonym is stronghold, as in the nation's citadel of health research. And that is a quote from Constance Holden, also as in a citadel of higher education. This is from the Middle French, citadel, from Old English, citadella, which is a diminutive of citade, which means city, from the Middle Latin civitas, and there's more at the word city. Next is citation, noun from the 13th century. One, an official summons to appear. And where are you appearing? Before a court. That is the example. 2a, an act of quoting, especially the citing of a previously settled case of law. 2a, an act of, wait, did I just read that? I did just read that. 2b, the synonyms are excerpt and quotation. Number 3, the synonym is mention, as 3a, a formal statement of the achievements of a person receiving an academic honor. 3b, specific reference in a military dispatch of meritorious performance of duty. And then finally, we have another synonym. It is encomium, E-N-C-O-M-I-U-M, encomium. And citational is an adjective. Next is cite, C-I-T-E. This is a verb from the 15th century. Let's see, is it just transitive? I think it is just transitive. One, to call upon officially or authoritatively to appear, as before a court. Two, to quote by way of example, authority, or proof, as in cites several noteworthy authors. 3a, to refer to, especially to mention formerly in commendation or praise. 3b, to name in a citation. 4. To bring forward or call to another's attention, especially as an example, proof, or precedent. As in, cited the weather as a reason for canceling the picnic. That is the reason, because we can't have a picnic outside when the weather is crappy. And then finally, we have the word summon as another synonym. Another synonym? I don't think there were any synonyms, so I don't know why I said another. And then citable is an adjective. This is from Anglo-French citare, which means to cite or summon, from the Latin citare, no, I think it would be citare, which means to put in motion, rouse, or summon. From ciere, which means to stir or move, and there's more at the suffix kinesis. Next is the word that I don't know how to pronounce. It is either cithara or kithara. I'm guessing either one is probably fine because it is a variation of kithara with a K. Next is cither. Okay, you could do it cither with a light th, or cither with a strong th. Cither. This is a noun from 1606, and the synonym is citern. C-I-T-T-E-R-N. Next is cited. Cited. It's like something has been cited. All right, let's read it. Adjective from 1660. Occupied by cities. It has been, this area has been occupied by cities, so it has now been cited. Citified is next. Adjective from 1828. Of, relating to, or characteristic of a sophisticated urban style of living. As in, citified tourists. Also as in, citified surroundings. And our last word is citify, C-I-T-I-F-Y. Transitive verb from 1828. The synonym is urbanize, and making it like a city. And then citification is a noun. Just a little west of where I live is, you know, there's the business area and there's a mall and stuff like that. And I remember when I was a kid, my dad said, because he grew up in the same town that I grew up in, he said, I remember when all this was cornfields. And it's just so funny to me to think that, you know, just this area that's not that far away, it's like a couple of miles maybe, was all cornfields. And so it has basically been citified in his lifetime. Okay, the words today were cyst, cistercian, cistern, cisterna, cistron, C-I-T, or cit, citadel, citation, cite, cithara, cither, citied, citified, and citified and citify. What are we gonna pick? Let's pick cistern as the word of the episode. If you have some liquid and you need a thing to put it in, just get yourself a cistern. Get yourself a cistern to put your liquids in. Your toilet is a cistern. All right, let's finish this up real quick. Let's just talk about the holidays. Let's see. Today is July 19th. Day of Arafat starts. It is also International Day of the Elimination of Sexual Violence in Conflict. It's the second day of Hajj. In Canada, K Day begins. Yes, that's the letter K. What else? In Myanmar, it is Martyrs Day. In Nicaragua, it is Sandinista Day or Liberation Day. And then what do we have for fun holidays? Eid el Adha. I'm not sure what that is. And then also National Daiquiri Day. So go have a daiquiri. We're going to end it there. We finished page 225. Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this is Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary, page 226. Here we go. Here we go. The first word is citizen. C-I-T-I-Z-E-N. Oh, that city is so zen. This is a noun from the 14th century. 1. An inhabitant of a city or town, especially one entitled to the rights and privileges of a free man or freeman. Yeah, okay. 2a. A member of a state. 2b. A native or naturalized person who owes allegiance to a government and is entitled to protection from it. 3. A civilian as distinguished from a specialized servant of the state. Citizenly is an adjective. Do we really use this word citizenly? Let's see. This is from Anglo-French, citizen, alternative of citizienne. No, there's no Z in there. Citine, from cité, which means city. There is some synonym information. Citizen, subject, and national mean a person owing allegiance to and entitled to the protection of a sovereign state. Citizen is preferred for one owing allegiance to a state in which sovereign power is retained by the people and sharing in the political rights of those people, as in the rights of a free citizen. Subject implies allegiance to a personal sovereign, such as a monarch, as in the king's subjects. National designates one who may claim the protection of a state and applies especially to one living or traveling outside that state, as in American nationals working in the Middle East. So now you know more about those words. Next is citizeness. Citizenette. So it's the word citizen with ESS at the end. This is a noun from 1796, and it is a woman who is a citizen. And I really would like to think that we don't use this word anymore. Because why? Can't you just have a non-gendered word? What is the point of that? I don't know. All right, next is citizenry. Noun from 1819, a whole body of citizens. Next is citizen's arrest. Two words. There is an apostrophe S in citizens. Noun from 1941. An arrest made not by a law officer, but by a citizen who derives authority from the fact of being a citizen. I've always wondered how this works exactly. It's not like citizens go around walking with handcuffs and things. It's like you just, it's very, it's non-physical. I'm just saying, hey, I'm doing a citizen's arrest, but the person is like, oh, okay, sorry, I have to stop what I'm doing now because you're a citizen. How often does this actually work? Next is citizens band. Two words, noun from 1948. A range of radio wave frequencies that in the U.S. is allocated officially for private radio communications. Next is citizenship. It is the boat where all the citizens go. It's a noun from 1611. One, the status of being a citizen. Two, a membership in a community, as a college. To be, the quality of an individual's response to membership in a community. Now we are in a new section, which will take us mostly into the next episode. We have the prefix CITR or CITRI or CITRO. Citra. Let's see. Number one, citrus, as in citriculture. Number two, citric acid, as in citrate. And then this is from the word citrus, which is its genus name. And yes, now let's get into all of this, all of these citra words. The first of those is citral, with an A-L at the end. Noun from 1891, an unsaturated liquid isomeric aldehyde, C10, H16, O, of many essential oils that has a strong lemon odor and is used especially in perfumery and as a flavoring. I wish that podcasts could have smell-o-vision, although it wouldn't be smell-o-vision. It would be, what would be the alternative word for vision? If there's a word, and we don't use it, so I can't think of what it is. Vision, all, aural, something. Anyway, smell-o-sound. Smell-o-sound. I want you to be able to smell the things because it has a very strong lemon odor. Hey, go grab some lemons and re-listen to the last 15 seconds. Next is citrate. Noun from 1794, a salt or ester of citric acid. Citric acid is next. It is two words. Noun from 1813, a tricarboxylic acid, C6H8O7, occurring in cellular metabolism, obtained especially from lemon and lime juices or by fermentation of sugars and used chiefly as a flavoring. Next is citric acid cycle. Three words, noun from 1942. The synonym is Krebs cycle, K-R-E-B-S, Krebs cycle. Next is citriculture, noun from 1916, the cultivation of citrus fruits, and citriculturist is a noun. They make all of those tasty citrus fruits for you. There's lemons and limes and oranges, and I guess grapefruit would be part of there, and then there's other ones that I can't think of. Next is citrine. Yes, citrine, C-I-T-R-I-N-E, first form, adjective, from the 14th century, resembling a citron or lemon, especially in color. A citron. Ooh, the citron will be the last word in this episode. This is from the Latin citrus, which means citron tree. Next is, well, it's spelled the same way, but it's pronounced citrine. Citrine, noun from 1748, a semi-precious yellow stone resembling topaz and formed by heating a black quartz in order to change its color. And maybe we should post a picture of this citrine stone to see what it looks like. Next we have citrinin. Citrinin, noun from 1931, a toxic antibiotic, C13H14O5, that is produced especially by a penicillium and an aspergillus, and is effective against some gram-positive bacteria. The scientific name for the penicillium is Penicillium citrinum, and the scientific name for Aspergillus is Aspergillus niveus, or niveus, or niveus. I don't know. Niveus. I'll say that. I said it. This is from New Latin, citrinum, or citrinum, which is a specific epithet of Penicillium citrinum. Okay, that was fun. Now we have the last word. It is citron, or just citron. C-I-T-R-O-N, noun from 1530. 1A, a citrus fruit resembling a lemon but larger with little pulp and a very thick rind. I don't think I'm aware of these citrons. Maybe I should find some. 1B, a small shrubby tree that produces citrons and is cultivated in tropical regions. And the scientific name of this tree is Citrus medica. 1C, the preserved rind of the citron used especially in cakes and puddings. And number 2, a small hard-fleshed watermelon used especially in pickles and preserves. We're going to have to learn more about this citron. Citron? Citron? I think it's citron. So the words today were citizen, citizeness, citizenry, citizen's arrest. That almost rhymed. Citizen's band, citizenship. Citra, citral, citrate, citric acid cycle, citriculture, citrine, citrine, citrinin, and citrin. Let's see. What do I like as the word of the episode? I shall pick this word. I'll pick citrin as the word of the episode because I'm not familiar with this fruit. And now I'm very curious. Citrin, citrin, it is a citrus fruit that's kind of like a lemon. And maybe it's sour, maybe it's not. I won't know until I put one in my mouth. All right, let's talk about the holidays. Eid al-Adha starts. It's also Colombian Independence Day. It's the third day of Hajj, that's Muslim observance. In Norway, it is Crown Prince Hakan Magnus's birthday. In Singapore, it is Hari Raya Haji. In Nigeria, it is Eid al-Kabir. And we already said it was Colombian Independence Day. And let's check this page. In Argentina and Brazil, it is Dia del Amigo. That's Day of the Friend. In Costa Rica, it is Engineers Day. It is International Chess Day. Where was I? I was just at somebody's house yesterday, and they had at least 2 chessboards out. I don't know if they actually play chess. I really should learn chess. I mean, I know it. I just don't play it. Honduras has Lempira Day. In Central African Republic, it is Tree Planting Day. Let's do that all over the place. It is National Lollipop Day. A lollipop, lollipop, oh, lolly, 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 lollipop, lollipop, oh, lolly, 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 lollipop. Boom, boom, boom. That was very weak. And finally, it is National Moon Day. I think, let's click on this page. July 20th, this was the day that they landed on the moon in 1969. 40, 50, how many? 52 years ago, I think. Am I doing my math correctly? I think I am. Happy National Moon Day. Go appreciate it. Go learn about it. There's a lot that people don't know. That's it. Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this is Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. Hello, hello, hello. Let's say some words into your ears. The first word is citronella. C-I-T. R-O-N-E-L-L-A, citronella, noun, from circa 1858, a lemon-scented grass of southern Asia that yields an oil used in perfumery and as an insect repellent, and then also just its oil. Yeah, citronella candles use the oil from the plants, I'm guessing. I was just talking to somebody yesterday who's got some citronella plants on her porch to get rid of the insects. This is from French citronelle, which means lemon balm. Next is citronellal. Citronellal. There's an L-A-L at the end. Noun from 1893. A lemon-odored aldehyde, C10H18O, that is derived especially from citronella oil and is used in perfumery and as an insect repellent. Similarly, we have citronellol. So it's L-O-L at the end instead of the L-A-L before. Citronellol. Noun from 1872. An unsaturated liquid alcohol, C10H20O, with a rose-like odor that is found in two optically active forms in many essential oils, as rose oil, and is used in perfumery and soaps. Next is Citravarum factor. Citravarum factor. Two words. Citravarum is C-I-T-R-O-V-O-R-U-M. This is a noun from 1948. A metabolically active form of folic acid that has been used in cancer therapy to protect normal cells against methotrexate. This is from the New Latin citravarum, which is a specific epithet of Leuconostoc citrovarum bacteria. Leuconostoc citrovarum, which is a bacterium that requires this form of folic acid. That was complicated. Next is citrulline. At the end, it is L-I-N-E. Noun from 1930. A crystalline amino acid, C6H13N3O3, formed especially as an intermediate in the conversion of ornithine and arginine. And I'm not sure what those are. Where were we? The etymology says this is from New Latin citrullus, which is the genus name of the watermelon. It's the genus name of the watermelon? And how is this related to the watermelon? I don't know. Do you know? Tell me. Next, we have the word citrus. Noun from 1825. Any of a group of often thorny trees and shrubs of the rue family. That is R-U-E. The rue family, grown in warm regions for their edible fruit with firm, usually thick rind and pulpy flesh. And then also just the fruit is citrus. And citrusy is an adjective. And let's see, citrus is the group name, and then other related genera. That's that. It does give the example oranges and lemons. Those are citrus. It seems like watermelon are citrus, although I never would have thought of that, but I guess they are. And there's a lot of other ones. Next is citrus canker. Two words, noun from 1916, a destructive disease of citrus caused by a bacterium that produces lesions on the leaves, twigs, and fruits. And the scientific name for this bacterium, it looks like there's a couple, Xanthomonas axanapodis citri. There's three words. I messed that up. Xanthomonas axanapodis citri. And then the other one is Xanthomonas campestris citri. Next is citrus red mite. Three words. Noun from 1945. A relatively large mite that is a destructive pest on the foliage of citrus. You got to watch out for the citrus canker and the citrus red mite. And the scientific name for this mite is Panonychus citri. Next is no more citrus words. My mouth is not working today. The next word is citern, C-I-T-T-E-R-N. And I feel like I have a hair stuck to my lip. What are you doing, hair? Get out of here. Get out of here, hair. Citern. Noun from 1566. A Renaissance stringed instrument like a guitar, with a flat pear-shaped body. And we will post a picture of this citern. It is a combination of cither and gittern. Gittern? Is that related to a guitar? It is spelled G-I-T-T-E-R-N. And so cither and gittern made a cittern. You could also say cithern, cithern, cittern. You could spell it with a th instead of a tt. It's different combinations of those two words. Anyway, moving on to the word city, c-i-t-y, noun from the 13th century, 1a, an inhabited, yes, an inhabited place of greater size, population, or importance than a town or village. 1b, an incorporated British town, usually of major size or importance, having the status of an episcopal see. What is a see? It's the word see, S-E-E, episcopal see. I don't understand that. We have a couple for 1C, and they are both capitalized. So 1C1, the financial district of London. 1C2, the influential financial interests of the British economy. 1D, a usually large or important municipality in the U.S. governed under a charter granted by the state. 1E, an incorporated municipal unit of the highest class in Canada. We're branching out to other countries in this one. Number two, the synonym is city-state, and there's a hyphen in between those two words. 3, the people of a city are called the city. 4, this is the last one, it is slang, a thing, event, or situation that is strongly characterized by a specified quintessential feature or quality, as in, the movie was Shoot Out City. Huh? The movie was Shoot Out City. Shoot Out City. The etymology says this is from Middle English, city, spelled with an IE at the end, which means large or small town, from Anglo-French, cité, from, let's see, from the Middle Latin, civitas, which is means citizenship or state or city of Rome, plus civis, which means citizen, and there's more at the word hind, H-I-N-D. That makes no sense to me. That is city. Now we have a number of city words. Some of them will be in the next episode. City clerk, two words, noun from 1793. A public officer charged with recording the official proceedings and vital statistics of a city. That's a very important job. We got to record all the stuff that's happening in the city. City clerk, thank you. Next is city council, two words, noun from 1789. The legislative body of a city. They take care of the stuff. They do the things. Next is city editor, two words, noun from 1834. A newspaper editor usually in charge of local news and staff assignments. And the last word is city father. Will we see city mother? I doubt it. Nope, we won't. City father, two words, noun from 1843. A member of the governing body of a city. And the example would be an alderman or councilman. Yep, those were all the words. Citronella, citronellol, citronellol, citroverum, citraverum factor, citrulline, citrus, canker, citrus, red mite, citern, city clerk, city council, city editor, and city father. Let's see. I think maybe I'll just pick citrus as the word of the episode. This is some good stuff for you. It gives you your vitamin C. We have gotten in the habit of making lemon waters in the morning. It's just some hot water and lemon, and it's very good to have before you eat anything. It alkalinizes your body and gets your body going, and it's just a very healthy thing to do. Well, we've sort of gotten out of the habit of it, but we're getting back into the habit of having some lemon water. It's good to get your citrus. Citrus, citrus, get that vitamin C in your body with some citrus. I don't know, I'm really tired today, so sorry for the lack of, I don't know, it's probably all the same. All the episodes are the same. Today is the fourth day of Hajj. It's in Belgium and the Netherlands. It is Belgian National Day. In Nigeria, it is the second day of Eid el-Kabir. In Mexico, it is National Secretary Day. In Argentina, it is National Law Day. It is, what else? In Guam, Liberation Day. That's from 1944. In Singapore, it is Racial Harmony Day. Oh, it would be so great if we had racial harmony all over the place. Maybe someday. In Russia, it is Summer Kazanskaya. Kazanskaya. And what are the fun holidays? National Junk Food Day. Oh yeah, I gotta have me some junk food. I love it so much. Don't we all love it? I try not to eat too much, but I know I eat more than I should. But man, I'm gonna have some junk food today. And then it is National Hot Dog Day. Hot dogs are probably one of the most junkiest of foods, because it's just the stuff. It's the stuff in a meat casing. We have vegan hot dogs. Honestly, brats are better. Italian sausages are better. There's not much flavor to a hot dog. There's not much to it, which is why you got to put all that extra stuff on it. Hot dogs are fine. They're not my favorite, but we do usually have hot dogs because Sharon loves hot dogs. But again, they're always the vegan hot dogs. Which brand do we get? Starts with an F. I can't think of it. We're going to end the episode there. Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this has been some information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. Oh, hey, I think we have hit episode 900. I know that I wasn't really paying attention to a lot of the other hundreds, but I'm going to try and pay a little bit more attention to those. So how many? Let's see, 420. I think it would be 25 pages from now. So would that be around page 250? We should be hitting episode 1,000. 1,000. Yeah, I'll mention that when we get there. Okay, the first word in this episode is City Hall. Two words, noun from 1675. One, the chief administrative building of a city. 2A, a municipal government. 2B, city officialdom or bureaucracy, as in, you can't fight City Hall. Next is city manager. Two words, noun from 1913. An official employed by an elected council to direct the administration of a city government. If you want to learn more about the city and what goes on in the city, you should watch the show Parks and Recreation, one of the best shows ever. Next is city planning, two words, noun from 1900, the drawing up of an organized arrangement of a city. And the example of that arrangement would be as of streets, parks, and business and residential areas. And then city planner is a noun. Next is city room, two words, noun from 1895. It's a whole city in a room. No. The department where local news is handled in a newspaper editorial office. Next is cityscape, noun from 1856. One, a city viewed as a scene. Oh, it's such a beautiful scene. Look at that city. Number two, an artistic representation of a city. Three, an urban environment, as in a cityscape cluttered with factories. That is very much a cityscape. Next is city slicker, two words, noun from 1924. And we have the number 2B definition for the word slicker. You young folks, you probably don't know about the movies. There was two of them called City Slickers. I don't think I saw the second one. I honestly can't remember. But the first one was fun. Okay, next is city, state. Two words with a hyphen. Noun from 1847. An autonomous state consisting of a city and surrounding territory. Next is citywide. Adjective from 1961. Including or involving all parts of a city, as in a citywide blackout. The whole city has no power, and that sucks. Next is an abbreviation, CIV, C-I-V. This is an abbreviation for civil, civilian, or civilization. Next is civet, C-I-V-E-T. Noun from 1532, one. Any of various old world carnivorous vivarid mammals with long bodies, short legs, and a usually long tail. I don't think I've heard of a civet animal We gotta find a picture and post it on the stuff. If you don't know what things I'm posting it on, go to Instagram at DictionaryPod. I also post the same thing on Facebook and Instagram at DictionaryPod. I don't have any of the other social media. But you can also email me. We talk about that stuff later. Number two. A thick, yellowish, musky-odored substance found in a sack near the anus of the civet. And it is used... Oh, boy. There's another one of these, and it's used in perfume. What was the other one? The beavers. Castoreum. They also... Humans somehow decided that they want to get... The liquid found in a sack near the anus of the beaver, and they use it in perfumes and flavorings and things. So if you ever see castor or castoreum, just avoid it. By the way, the genera of this civet are Civetictus, Vivera, and Viverecula. What is a viverid mammal? I'm going to have to look that up. I don't know what that is. V-I-V-E-R-R-I-D. Viverid. Oy, oy, oy. Why? What's wrong with humans? Why do we do these things? The name of this civet is from Middle French, civet, with a T-E at the end. From Old Italian, zibetto. From Arabic, zabad, which is civet or perfume. Or no, wait, actually, it's just civet perfume. Again. Why? Moving on to civet cat. It's probably a cat. Number two. Two words. Noun from 1607. Number one is the number one definition for the word civet. Number two. It's the number two definition for the word ringtail. That's a kind of animal. I think it has rings in its tail, like the colors. Black and maybe orange? I don't know. Number three, any of several small spotted skunks of Western North America. If it's a skunk, why is it called a civet cat? By the way, the genus name of that skunk is Spilogale? It's probably Spilogale. Okay, moving on to civic. Adjective from, that's a palindrome. It's from circa 1656. Of or relating to a citizen, a city, citizenship, or community affairs, as in civic duty, also as in civic pride. Civically is an adverb. And let's see, this is from the Latin civicus, from civis, which means citizen, and there's more at the word city. Next is civic-minded, two words with a hyphen, adjective from 1947, disposed to look after civic needs and interests, and civic-mindedness is a noun. You gotta be civic-minded. You gotta think about the city and the people in the city and be aware and help them out. That's civic-minded, I think. Next is civics. Noun from 1886, a social science dealing with the rights and duties of citizens. That's good stuff to learn. And our last word is civil, C-I-V-I-L. We got a number of definitions, and we have synonym information. This is an adjective from the 14th century. One, of or relating to citizens. It's very civil. 1b, of or relating to the state or its citizenry, as in civil strife. 2a, synonym is civilized, as in civil society. We should all be civil, but sometimes we shouldn't be because we need to fight for change. 2b, adequate in courtesy and politeness, and a synonym is mannerly, as in a civil question. 3a, of relating to or based on civil law. 3b, relating to private rights and to remedies sought by action or suit distinct from criminal proceedings. 3C, established by law. And, oh no, there's a 5, sorry. 4, of relating to or involving the general public, their activities, needs, or ways, or civic affairs as distinguished from special affairs. And examples of those special affairs would be military or religious. And then number 5 is talking about time. Based on the mean sun and legally reorganized for use in ordinary affairs. I do not know what that means. I think, let's take a look at this. I have an app that will show, I have a couple actually, but this one, it shows the sun, the route the sun is going to take. You can choose a location, a time, and there's all these very technical terms. And I think is one of them civil something? I don't know. I don't see the word civil anywhere. Let's see. I'm just doing a quick little check. Civil. Nope, I'm not seeing it. But supposedly it has something to do with the sun, I guess. Alrighty, let's talk about the synonyms. Civil, polite, courteous, gallant, or gallant. Gallant. See, I get confused about that word. Gallant? Gallant? All right, hey, you know what? We're going to skip ahead to... I just saw the word hard-assed. Let's skip to gallant or gallant and figure it out once and for all. I bet you both of them are totally good. Almost there. Game hen, gallantine, Okay, we're getting there. We're getting there. G-A-L-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Nobody wants to listen to this. Okay, here we go. We have 3 forms of gallant. Let's see. Gallant would be... That's a person. Gallant would be... Spirited, brave, splendid. Gallant is... Man, this is, I don't know if this is helping, but... I'll just say gallant. It just sounds so much more fancy. All right, let's start the synonym information over again. Civil, polite, courteous, gallant, and chivalrous mean observant of the forms required by good breeding. Civil often suggests little more than the avoidance of overt rudeness, as in, owed the questioner a civil reply. Polite commonly implies polish of speech and manners and sometimes suggests an absence of cordiality, as in, if you can't be pleasant, at least be polite. Sometimes. Courteous implies more actively considerate or dignified politeness, as in clerks who were unfailingly courteous to customers. Gallant or gallant and chivalrous imply courteous attentiveness, especially to women. Gallant suggests spirited and dashing behavior and ornate expressions of courtesy, as in a gallant suitor of the old school. A gallant suitor of the old school. And chivalrous suggests high-minded and self-sacrificing behavior, as in chivalrous display of duty. That is it for all of the words. Let's reread them. City hall, city manager, city planning, city room, cityscape, city slicker, city state, citywide, civet cat, civic, civic-minded, civics, and civil. I will pick civil as the word of the episode. Sounds very strange now. I guess I like being civil. I tend to avoid confrontation, but at the same time, as I said before, sometimes you need to not be civil. You can't just sit by and be cool and let things happen. You need to break out of that civil, courteous, polite mode, and you got to say something, you got to do something. So, I encourage you all to do that. I also encourage myself to do that. Civil, civil, civil. Sometimes it's good to be civil. Sometimes it shouldn't be civil. Some holidays. 5th and last day of Hajj. Eid el-Adha ends. That's it for that website. Let's check this website. In Azerbaijan, are we on the right page? The date, yes, July 22nd. In Azerbaijan, where did it go? I lost my... Is National Press Day. In Swaziland, it is birthday of the late King Shobuja. Shobuja. In the U.S., it is the earliest day on which Parents' Day can fall. In the Gambia, it is a Revolution Day. It is Rat Catcher's Day. In Sarawak, Malaysia, It is Sarawak Self-Government Day. And let's look at the fun holidays. It is National Hammock Day. I wish I had a place to put a hammock. I want to just sit in a hammock right now because I'm still very tired. It's Selena Gomez's birthday. I think it's odd that her birthday was added to this page because not a lot of other, or no, I haven't seen any other famous people's birthdays in here. I don't know. I think that's sort of odd, but hey, happy birthday, Selena. And then finally, it is Pi Approximation Day. And I had to read the link on that because I was very confused. Why is July 27th Pi Approximation Day? But I figured out, I realized that, you know, I realized by reading, I didn't figure it out on my own because I'm not that smart. If you write the day first, 22/7, as a lot of other countries do other than America, which I think actually makes the most sense, the day and then the month, 22/7, 22 divided by 7 is an approximation for pi, you know, pi circles 3.1415 something something. So it's 22 divided by 7 is very close to pi, which is why it is Pi Approximation Day. All right. I think that's all I got to say. Thank you very much for listening, and until next time, this is Spencer dispensing information. Goodbye. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds, word turds, word birds, word fjords? No. Thank you for turning on this podcast. I very much appreciate it. If you would be so kind, if you are listening to this, please rate and review. You know, podcasters want you to do that. So go do it. It literally will take you 5 seconds. You hit the 5 stars, you type in something nice, even if you hate it. Although if you hated it, why are you listening? Don't listen, but go tell somebody else who might like it. You can do that. You can email me, dictionarypod@gmail.com, Twitter, Instagram, @dictionarypod. There is a Google Voice number in the show notes, and you can call that and leave me a voicemail, and maybe I'll play it in an episode. And then you can say, I'm on a podcast. At the end of the last episode, we had the word civil, and every single one of these words will start with civil. And even in the next episode, we'll have a few more. Lots of civil words. Sometimes they mean about, you know, the city and being nice, I guess. I don't know. Let's read them. The first one is civil death. 2 words. Noun from 1719. The status of a living person equivalent in its legal consequences to natural death. Specifically, deprivation of civil rights. We are going to see civil rights at the end of this episode. Next is civil defense, 2 words, noun from 1939. The system of protective measures and emergency relief activities conducted by civilians in case of hostile attack, sabotage, or natural disaster. Next is civil disobedience, 2 words, noun from 1866. Refusal to obey governmental demands or commands, especially as a nonviolent and usually collective means of forcing concessions from the government. Lots of people getting together nonviolently saying no government or no big group, we're not going to cower to your demands. Is there a cat trying to get in here? Possibly. Okay, next is civil engineer, 2 words, noun from circa 1792, an engineer whose training or occupation is in the design and construction, especially of public works. And examples of those public works are roads or harbors. And civil engineering is a noun. Next is civilian, noun from the 14th century. Is that the word villain? V-I? No, I think that would be 2 L's. Number 1, a specialist in Roman or modern civil law. 2A, one not on active duty in the armed services or not on a police or firefighting force. Civilian. 2B, the number 1 definition for the word outsider. And civilian is an adjective. Most of us are civilians. Next is civilianize. civilianize. This is a transitive verb from 1870, to convert from military to civilian status or control. And civilianization is a noun. If you get out of the military and you become just a regular person, you become a civilian, you are going through the act of civilianization. I don't think it's, I just have this idea in my mind of like, it's some sci-fi movie and you have to go through the civilianization process in some laboratory and they stick you with needles or they do something, but that's not at all what it is. It's just probably some documents and that's it. It's nowhere near as interesting. Next is civilization and civilize, spelled with an S, because this is the chiefly British variation of civilization and civilize with Z's. Next is civility, noun from 1533. Number one is archaic, training in the humanities. 2A, civilized conduct, especially the synonyms courtesy and politeness. And I lost my place. There we go. 2B, a polite act or expression. Next is civilization, noun from 1772. There's that game, the PC game, although it might be on other things too. Civilization, they're, I don't know what number they on, 13 now? Who knows? But I remember playing that with a friend of mine back in, must have been high school. I don't know what version we were on, 3, 4, maybe, something like that. And we literally played it all night. We never went to bed. I was more watching and he was more playing. And, you know, you start in like the medieval ages or before that or something. And I think we got into the futuristic time. I think we had spaceships and fancy buildings. That was an interesting game. Okay, civilization, 1A, a relatively high level of cultural and technological development, specifically the stage of cultural development at which writing and the keeping of written records is attained. 1B, the culture characteristic of a particular time or place. 2, the process of becoming civilized. 3A, refinement of thought, manners, or taste. 3B, a situation of urban comfort. Civilizational is an adjective. And next we have civilize, verb from 1601, starting with transitive. 1A, no, just one, there's no A. 1, to cause, to develop out of a primitive state. You become civilized. If you start as primitive, you become civilized, and then what are you? You are a civilian. I don't know. And then it says especially, to bring to a technically advanced and rationally ordered state of cultural development. Maybe aliens look at us and they say, we are so primitive. They say they are so primitive. And then they will civilize us and we will become technologically advanced. 2A, synonyms are educate and refine. 2B, the number one definition for the word socialize. And then we have one definition for intransitive, to acquire the customs and amenities of a civil community. Civilizer is a noun. Next is civilized, adjective from 1611, characteristic of a state of civilization, as in civilized society, especially characterized by taste, refinement, or restraint. I guess I kind of like being civilized to an extent, but sometimes don't you just want to not be civilized and just be ridiculous? I think we all want that. Next is civil law. Two words, noun from the 14th century. Number one, Roman law, especially as set forth in the Justinian Code. 2, the body of private law developed from Roman law and used in Louisiana and in many countries outside the English-speaking world. I never would have thought Louisiana and Roman law would be in the same sentence. Number 3, the law established by a nation or state for its own jurisdiction. And 4, the law of civil or private rights. Next is civil liberty, two words, noun from 1644. freedom from arbitrary governmental interference, specifically by denial of governmental power, and in the U.S., especially as guaranteed by the Bill of Rights. That is usually used in plural, civil liberties. And the example of this governmental interference is with the right of free speech. Man, I feel like if I had a smarter person on as a guest, they could talk a lot about this, but I cannot say a whole lot. But yes, there's the Bill of Rights. We have civil liberties, and sometimes people forget that. Civil libertarian is a noun or adjective. Next is civilly. C-I-V-I-L-L-Y. Civilly. Adverb from the 15th century. Number one, in terms of civil rights, law, and law or matters, as in civilly dead. This is a very strange word. Number two, in a civil manner, and the synonym is politely. You were very polite. You did that politely. You did that civilly. I don't think we usually use this word. Next is civil marriage. Two words, noun from 1820. A marriage performed by a magistrate. And then finally, we have civil rights. Two words, noun from 1658. The non-political rights of a citizen, especially the rights of personal liberty guaranteed to U.S. citizens by the 13th and 14th Amendments to the Constitution and by acts of Congress. I think I will probably post at least one link in the show notes, if not more, to give more information on that, specifically the 13th and 14th Amendments. Man, this is a big topic. Very big topic. Again, maybe I should have had somebody smart to talk about this. All right, so the words were civil death, civil defense, civil disobedience, civil engineer, civilian, civilianize, civilization, civilize, civility, civilization, civilize, civilized, civil law, civil liberty, civilly, civil marriage, and civil rights. There's a lot of good stuff in here. I am honestly torn between civil disobedience and civil rights, and I'm gonna yawn because I'm tired. It's nap time for me. Civil disobedience and civil rights. I mean, I'll just pick them both because they're both incredibly important and just something that, you know, needs to be talked about, needs to be done. I really, really like the idea of civil disobedience. If there is something that is not good, not right, you know, you can do some civil disobedience. And remember, you're doing it as a group usually, but I guess you could do it by yourself, but it's nonviolent. We need to stress the nonviolent portion of that. Oh boy. If you would like to say some things about what you feel about really any of these words, but specifically civil disobedience and civil rights, I encourage you to send me an email, DM me on the social media, call in, leave a voicemail. This is, you know, these are really important things that need to be talked about. So, on that note, let's talk about the holidays. Are there any interesting holidays? Oh, hey, it's National Vanilla Ice Cream Day. So go have some vanilla ice cream. In the Rastafari religion, it is birthday of Haile Selassie. In Indonesia, it is Children's Day. In Papua New Guinea, it is National Remembrance Day. In Oman, it is Renaissance Day. In Egypt, it is Revolution Day. And the fun holidays for July 23rd. There's only one, although I would argue that National Vanilla Ice Cream Day should be on this list, but no, it is National Gorgeous Grandma Day. I just love the idea of this. Let's see, what does it have to say? It's not just Grandma Day, it's Gorgeous Grandma Day. Today is the day to tell old granny just how stunning she really is. She looks fly for an 80-year-old. I did not write this, somebody else wrote this. Yeah, so if your grandma is still around, tell her how awesome she is and how gorgeous she is and how beautiful she is and how great she is, because, you know, you got a great grandma, a great gorgeous grandma. Unfortunately, both of my grandmas have passed, but they were gorgeous and great and amazing, and generous and nice and funny, and I miss them. I miss them dearly. Oh man, I'm actually getting a little emotional. All right, let's end the episode. Thank you very much for listening, and until next time, this is Spencer dispensing information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to another episode of the most amazing podcast in the world. It's called The Dictionary, hosted by me, Spencer Parks. How are you doing, word turds? We're at the top of page 227. I think I got a burp coming just because I just had some water. The first word in this episode is civil servant. Two words. Noun from 1800. One. A member of a civil service. That will be our next word. But first we have number two. A member of the administrative staff of an international agency. Man of mystery, international agency of mystery. I don't know what I'm saying. Next is civil service. Two words. Noun from circa 1770. The administrative service of a government or international agency exclusive of the armed forces, especially one in which appointments are determined by competitive examination. Next is civil union. Two words, noun from 1992. The legal status that ensures the same-sex couples' specified rights and responsibilities of married couples. Yay! And then, of course, not all that long ago from when I'm recording this, gay marriage was just legalized all over the place. And so that made us very, very happy. Okay, next is civil war. Two words, noun from the 15th century. A war between opposing groups of citizens of the same country. It's a very paradoxical word. Civil war, it's not civil. War isn't civil. It just means that they're part of the same country. It's a very odd name. Next is Civitan. Civitan, capital Civitan, noun from 1926, a member of a major national and international service club. And it's from Civitan, or it's the word Civitan, which means club. I don't know, that doesn't make any sense. Okay, next is Civi, C-I-V-V-Y or C-I-V-I-E. Noun from circa 1889. One is plural, so civvies. Civilian clothes as distinguished from a particular uniform, as of the military. And then number two, the synonym is civilian. So the people who are in the military, they will call civilians civvies, or they will call their civilian clothes civvies. I have only worn civvies in my life. Next is Civvy Street. Two words, noun from 1943. It is British and it means civilian life. So it's not the street that the civilians live on, although it is, but it's in general, it's just the life of the civilian, civilian life. They're on Civvy Street. Next is, and we've got some abbreviations, CIWS, all caps. This is an abbreviation for Close-In Weapons System, CIWS. Next abbreviation is CJ, all caps. It's for Chief Justice. Next is CJD, all caps. This is for Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease. Now, could it be Creutzfeldt-Jakob disease? Possibly. I'm not sure. Creutzfeldt is spelled Creutzfeldt hyphen Jakob disease. Next is CK, all lowercase, abbreviation for one, cask, or two, check. Next is CL, abbreviation, all lowercase, number one, centiliter. Two, claiming. Like, I'm claiming this for America. Three, class. Four, clause, with an E at the end. Five, close. Six, closet. Although, if you look at the word close and then you add a T, you would want to say close it. Close it, that closet. No, it's closet. And then seven, cloth. Cl, again, this is with a capital C. It's a symbol for chlorine. Cl again, all caps, abbreviation for 1, carload, 2, center line, 3, civil law, and 4, common law. Okay, next is clabber, with 2 B's in the middle. B as in boy, or babushka. This is a noun from 1634. It is a chiefly dialect, and it means sour milk that has thickened or curdled. It's a clabber. It is short for bonny clabber, which is all one word. Bonny clabber. Who made this up? How did this become the slang, the dialect for sour milk that has thickened or curdled? Bonny clabber. Next is clabbered with an ED. I suspect it is similar. Adjective from 1873. It is talking about milk or cream, and it means having thickened or curdled. That milk or cream is clabbered. Next is clocken. Maybe you would say clochen. I think you got to add a little ch in the middle there. Clocken. It is a noun from the 15th century. It is Scottish and Irish, and the synonym is Hamlet. H-A-M-L-E-T. Now, would that be the person, the Hamlet? The person Hamlet, or is a Hamlet a little town? But either way, it is a clacken. Next is clack. C-L-A-C-K. First form verb from the 13th century. 1, the synonyms are chatter and prattle. Number 2, to make an abrupt striking sound or series of sounds. 3 is talking about fowl, the birds, fowl. And the synonyms are cackle and cluck. By the way, I should have mentioned that these are the intransitive definitions. So, you know, rewind and listen to those again if you want. And now we are on the transitive definitions. 1, to cause, to make a clatter. 2, to produce with a chattering sound. And then specifically the synonym is blab, B-L-A-B. Clacker is a noun. Second form of clack, noun from the 15th century, 1a, rapid, continuous talk, and the synonym is chatter. 1b, the synonym is tongue, like your tongue, it's in your mouth. Number 2, is archaic, an object, as a valve, that produces clapping or rattling sounds, rattling noises, usually in regular rapid sequence. And number 3, a sound of clacking. Next is, I love this word, clactonian. Clactonian. It's basically spelled how it sounds, with a capital C at the beginning. C-L-A-C-T-O-N-I-A-N. Clactonian. This is an adjective from 1932. It seems like it would be somebody who lives on the planet Clack. Clack. Why do I like to say that word? This is of or relating to a lower Paleolithic culture, usually characterized by stone flakes with a half cone at the point of striking. That is so specific. By the way, this is from Clacton on Sea, and that is in England. I think I may need to find where this place is, and I'll share a link in the show notes. I'm trying to add a little bit more to the show notes. Not a whole lot, just a little bit. So Clacton on Sea. So it's Clacton hyphen on hyphen sea, like the water sea. Is that a name of a town? Interesting. I am a Clactonian. I like to clack the rocks on the stone and make flakes. Next is the word clad. This is the first form of 4, well, kind of 5. Let's see, the first one is the past and past participle of the word clothe. So if you are clothed, you are clad in something. Second form of clad, adjective from the 14th century. Just making sure my record is still going on. Yes, it is. Great. Good job, Spencer. Number 1, being covered or clothed, as in ivy-clad buildings. 2 is talking about a coin, consisting of outer layers of one metal bonded to a core of a different metal. And the third form of clad is a verb, a transitive verb from 1939. The synonyms are sheath. Now, there's an E at the end, so would you say sheath, sheath, and face? Specifically, there's a definition. Specifically, to cover a metal with another metal by bonding. So that metal has been covered with another metal, and it is clad. And if I can find this quickly, there was a word that I came across, circumambient. I think it was one of those circum words. This is surrounded. The metal is circumambulated ambiently by another metal. Next is the fourth form of clad, noun from 1941. 1A, a composite material formed by cladding. It's probably the metal one. 1B, a clad coin. 2, synonym is cladding with an ing, and then specifically the outer layer of a clad coin would be the cladding, also clad. Now we have clad again, but this is a prefix, could also be claddo. No year, and it means slip or sprout, as in cladophyll, cladophyll, cladophyll. So what's the etymology of this? It is from the Greek prefix clad or clado with a K instead of a C, from clados, which means branch or shoot of a tree, and it is akin to the Old English holt, which means woods, and there's more at the word holt. So it's a sprout, a little sprout. It's the prefix clad. All right. Last word for this episode is cladda, 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 C-L-A-D-D-A-G-H, cladda. I think that's the best way to pronounce it. This is a noun from 1922, an Irish design, as on a ring, of two hands holding a crowned heart that symbolizes friendships, loyalty, and love. Aw, how sweet. So this is from Calada, which is a former village across the River Corrib from Galway City, Ireland. Assuming that's the same as just Galway. I've been there. I've been to Galway. I didn't know I was so close to Calada. Many people have Calada rings, however you want to say it. And I know that there are rules, like if you wear it on this hand facing this direction, it means one thing. And if you have it facing the other direction, it means another thing. And you put it on the other hand, it means something else. Maybe even which finger you have it on, it means something else. I don't know. If I feel so inspired, I'll see if I can find a website that lists all the different possibilities. So you can use that as a reference if you have a clatter ring. You know, it's like, I'm in a relationship, or I was just in a relationship and I'm looking, or I'm not in a relationship and I'm not looking, or so many different options. It's a very versatile ring, but it's really just the design is the cladda. So obviously, you know, somebody in cladda, the cladda village, which doesn't exist anymore, I guess, they designed this thing. Okay, let's reread the words. Civil servant, civil service, civil union, civil war, civitan or civitan, civi, civi street, C-I-W-S, CJ, CJD, CK, CL, 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 collabor, collabored, clachen, clack, clactonian, clad, clad, clada, clada. I will pick civil union as the word of the episode because I think when this was, I don't want to say invented, that's not the right word, but when this was created, this really helped out a whole lot of people, and that was really good. So, civil unions, you are great. That's the song. Yeah. All right, let's read the holidays. Today is July 24th. In the U.S., it is Cousins Day. It's also National Tequila Day. Have some tequila, but be careful. Internationally, it's International Self-Care Day. Gotta go take care of yourself. If you got to take care of yourself, because how can you take care of other people if you can't take care of yourself? So try both. In Greece, it is the restoration of democracy. By the way, it is also Cousins Day in Australia, Canada, India, and South Africa. and it is also National Tequila Day in the UK. And in Ecuador and Venezuela, it is birthday of Simon Bolivar. What other holidays? In Tunisia, it is Carnival of Awusu. In Vanuatu, it's Children's Day. In Utah, it is Pioneer Day. In Poland, it is Police Day. Poland Police Day. In Venezuela, it is also Navy Day. It's also Simon Bolivar Day in Bolivia and Colombia. Don't know why those weren't mentioned on the other page. And what are some of the other fun holidays? Asalha Puja. I don't know what that is, but there's a picture of the Buddha, so it's probably related to Buddhism. It's National Amelia Earhart Day. It's probably her birthday today. Happy birthday, Amelia Earhart, if you can hear me. It's National Day of the Cowboy. Maybe you should watch Toy Story. It's National Drive-Thru Day, so you can go through a drive-thru while drinking tequila with your cousin dressed like a cowboy. Yeah, I think that's it. But don't drink the tequila while you're driving. That's a very, 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 very bad idea. All right, we're going to end the episode there. Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this is Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. This is Spencer, your host. I am so glad you're here. There are a bunch of words in this episode that are very odd to me. This will be fun to see what the definitions are. Okay, yeah. Anything? I think we're good. Let's start. Ready, set, go. The first word is cladding. C-L-A-D-D-I-N-G. Noun from 1936. Something that covers or overlays. Specifically, metal coating bonded to a metal core. And that is obviously very similar to the ones that we read in the last episode, clad. It's all about putting metal on other metal. Next is clade. So we got an E at the end. Clade. Noun from 1911. A group of biological taxa as species that includes all descendants of one common ancestor. So, a group of biological taxa that includes all descendants of one common... So if you take one ancestor and then you combine that with all of the descendants from that one ancestor, that is called a clade. That must be very large. There's a lot of individuals, depending on how old the ancestor is. Next is cladistics. C-L-A-D-I-S-T-I-C-S. Cladistics. Noun from 1965. It's kind of a long definition. A system of biological taxonomy that defines taxa uniquely by shared characteristics not found in ancestral groups and uses inferred evolutionary relationships to arrange taxa in a branching hierarchy such that all members of a given taxon have the same ancestors. Cladist or cladist is a noun, cladistic is an adjective, and cladistically is also an adverb. Obviously, that's related to clade. Next, maybe this is related. It is, nah, probably not. Cladocerin. Cladocerin. C-L-A-D-O-C-E-R-A-N. Noun from 1909. Any of an order, Cladocera, of minute, chiefly freshwater branchiopod crustaceans that includes the water fleas. Let's see. This is from Cladocera, clad plus the Greek keras, which means horn. So maybe they have little horns? I don't know. But they are cladocerin. Next is cladode. Cladode? Cladode. Let's say cladode. Noun from 1870, and we have the synonym cladophil. That was the word that was the example for the prefix clad in the previous episode, and cladophil is coming up, so we will get to learn what it is. But cladode is a synonym for it. Cladodial. Cladodial. That is an adjective. Cladodial. All right, next is cladogenesis. Cladogenesis. Noun. Well, so if we look at the word, we've got genesis. that's like the beginning of something. And then Clado, if we look at the previous episode, Clado, it's talking about a slip or a sprout, a branch, something like that. So I'm going to say that the cladogenesis would be like the beginning of a new sprouting thing. All right, let's read it. Noun from 1953, evolutionary change characterized by tree-like branching of taxa. And then it says compared to anagenesis. You know, so I was close. I was super close. Cladogenetic. Cladogenetic is an adjective, and cladogenetically is an adverb. All right, next is cladogram. Noun from 1965, a branching diagrammatic tree. A branching diagrammatic tree used in cladistic classification to illustrate phylogenetic relationships. So this prefix clad, I mean, it's maybe literally talking about a tree or a branch or something, but it's also like, you know, the tree of life and how, you know, your family tree and all those things are a tree. There's things branching off of other things. Yeah, that's that. Next is cladophyll, cladophyll, noun from 1879, a flattened photosynthetic branch assuming the form of and closely resembling an ordinary foliage leaf. If it is clear, maybe I will find a picture of this cladophyll, but maybe there is no good visual representation. We'll find out. I don't know. Next is clafouti. No, that's not how you pronounce it. You say, I think that's the, I emphasize the wrong part. Clafouti, clafouti. I believe that's correct. It is spelled C-L-A-F-O-U-T-I, or you can put an S at the end. Clafouti, noun from circa 1968. A dessert, I'm hooked, a dessert consisting of a layer of fruit, as cherries, topped with batter and baked. Wow. All right, let's find this thing, a clafouti. Next, all right, the rest of the words are much more clear to me. The first one of those, the rest of the words, here we go. I don't know what I'm saying. Claim, that's the word. Claim, C-L-A-I-M, first form, verb from the 14th century. Let's see, is it starting with transitive or is it all transitive? I think it is all transitive. All right. 1A, to ask for, especially, as a right, as in, claimed the inheritance. That inheritance is mine, I am claiming it as my right. That's very greedy. 1B, to call for. Synonym is require. As in, this matter claims our attention. 1C, the synonym is woe. The 16B definition for the word take, T-A-K-E. Wow. All right. As in, the accident claimed her life. Oh, she dead. Take. The 16B definition for the word take means to take a life, probably. And on that note, let's move on to number 2. To take as the rightful owner. 3A. To assert in the face of possible contradiction. Synonym is maintain. As in, claimed that he'd been cheated. I maintain that I've been cheated, and that is my claim. 3B, to claim to have, as in, organization which claims 11,000 members. That is a quote from Rolling Stone. What organization were they talking about? This organization claims to have 11,000 members. I guess it's a lot, but I'm sure there are organizations with more than 11,000. 3C, to assert to be rightfully one's own, as in, claimed responsibility for the attack. And finally, a synonym is demand, and claimable is an adjective. This is from the Latin clamare, which means to cry out or shout. It is akin to the Latin calare, which means to call, and there's more at the word low, L-O-W. All right, next is the second form of claim. It is a noun from the 14th century. 1. A demand for something due or believed to be due, as in, an insurance claim. 2A. A right to something, specifically a title to a debt, privilege, or other thing in the possession of another. 2b, an assertion open to challenge, as in a claim of authenticity. 3, something that is claimed, especially a tract of land staked out. That's it for claim. Next is claimant. Claim with an A-N-T. I said that kind of weird. Claim ant, noun from the 15th century. One that asserts a right or title, as in a claimant to an estate. And then also the number one definition for the word claimer. So yes, if you are claiming something, you can be the claimant. I think usually it's for insurance, probably. But hey, let's read the word claimer. Claimer, noun from the 15th century. One that claims. 2a, the synonym is claiming race, which we will get to shortly. And then 2b, a horse running in a claiming race. But what is a claiming race? It's two words, noun from 1935. A horse race in which each entry is offered for sale for a specified price that must be deposited before the race. I don't understand that. But next, we are on the last word of this episode. It is, I guess you would pronounce it, clairaudience? Clairaudience. So it's Claire, C-L-A-I-R, and then the word audience, all one word. This is a noun from 1864. The power or faculty of hearing something not present to the ear, but regarded as having objective reality. The power of hearing something in the ear, but it's not there, but it is real. Objectively, it is real. Huh. All right. This is interesting. Clairaudient is an adjective. Clairaudiently is an adverb. And then this is from the prefix clair, which is from the word clairvoyance, plus the word audience, like the act of hearing. So it's the audio form of the word clairvoyance, I guess. And clairvoyance is actually the first word of the next episode. I am curious to see what the dictionary has to say about these. This is a very interesting concept, clairaudience. Okay, so the words today were cladding, clade, cladistics, cladocerin, cladode, cladogenesis, cladogram, cladophil, clafouti, claim, claimant, claimer, claiming race, and clairaudience. Well, I am super fascinated by clairaudience. But I also really like clafouti, and also cladistics is just the study of, I like that one, cladistics, that's the word of the episode, because it's the system that it's like mapping all the stuff out, I should probably actually read the proper words, the ancestral groups and the characteristics and all that stuff. I just think that's kind of fascinating. Cladistics, it's all about just the group, the ancestral groups. All right, let's read the holidays. What are we on? July 25th? Okay. It is St. James, TG. I don't know what the TG is. It's Parents' Day. We love your parents. I mean, you know, some people may not like their parents, but you brought us into existence, and we have mixed feelings about that. In Costa Rica, it is annexation of Guanacaste. In the Dominican Republic, it is Father's Day. In Spain, actually, I think that might be the earliest day Father's Day can fall. We'll read the other page in a second. In Spain, it is Galicia National Day, or Galicia National Day. In Russia and Ukraine, it is Navy Day. In Cuba, it is Revolution Anniversary. In Venezuela, it is Founding of Caracas City. What does this other page have to say? It says, it's the earliest day on which Father's Day can fall in the Dominican Republic. It's also the earliest day for National Tree Planting Day in Australia. And in Russia, it's the earliest day for Navy Day. So it's, you know, it's the earliest day. In Jamaica, it is National Baha'i Day. In Puerto Rico, it is Puerto Rico Constitution Day. In Tunisia, it is Republic Day. And what are our fun holidays? Ooh. Ooh. National Wine and Cheese Day. That's something my wife has fairly often. So today, we'll definitely have some wine and cheese. Like I said, it's National Parents Day, so say hello to your parents and tell them that you love them and that you're grateful for them. And then finally, it is National Hot Fudge Sundae Day. National Hot Fudge Sundae Day. You can have that as your dessert after wine and cheese. Or you can flip it around if you want. That's fine. I approve of that. All right. That's the end of this episode. Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this is Spencer, dispensing information. Bye-bye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. This is a fun podcast, isn't it? You know, I was thinking I would probably be doing this anyway, even if I weren't recording it. I think that there's part of me that would be like, yeah, just read the dictionary a little bit at a time, because it honestly is super fascinating. And I think, well, if you're not listening to this, you won't hear me say this, but if you're not listening to this, you should just go read the dictionary. You don't need me to say it. But hey, if you are listening regularly, that is pretty awesome. And it warms me little heart. All right, let's talk about the first word. It is clairvoyance. C-L-A-I-R-V-O-Y-A-N-C-E. This is a noun from 1838. One, the power or faculty of discerning objects not present to the senses. The power or faculty of discerning objects. So the other one that we had yesterday was clairaudience. That was sounds. This is objects. This is seeing things or being aware that an object is there when it's not really there, right? That's what it's saying. All right. Number two, ability to perceive matters beyond the range of ordinary perception. And the synonym is penetration. So the idea of clairvoyance and clairaudience, if it is what I'm thinking, so the easiest example of, like, there's somebody who is born who has the ability in their eyes, they're like a mutant, they have the ability to see, you know, ultraviolet light. There's visible light, and then there's light on either side with longer waveforms and shorter waveforms, because everything's energy. So is this saying that there are people who scientifically have the ability to perceive things like the sound that's like, objectively, we know that an animal is making a high-range frequency sound that humans can't hear, but this person is clairaudience, so they can actually hear that sound. Is that what clairvoyance and clairaudience is? I don't know. It makes it sound like it's a bit more scientific than something saying, like, somebody who can see auras. You know, there's, like, no science behind that. So I just find this super fascinating. Okay, next is clairvoyant. So it's the D at the end. This is the first form adjective from 1844. One, having clairvoyance, able to see beyond the range of ordinary perception. See, that supports what I think. I don't know. If you are an expert on clairvoyance, I want to talk to you. Or, actually, even better, if you are clairvoyant, if you technically have the ability to hear sounds lower or higher than what is typical sounds that we can hear, or same with sight or whatever, is there a version for smell? I mean, smell is, it's all energy. Is there like ultrasonic smells and the opposite of that? I can't think of the word. That would be interesting. All right. So clairvoyant, I read the first one, as in, claims to be clairvoyant. I do not claim to be clairvoyant. I wish I could. This is awesome, but I cannot. Number two, of or relating to clairvoyance, as in, clairvoyant powers. Ooh, with the clairvoyant powers I have, I can see something. I can hear something. Clairvoyantly is an adverb. I should look at the etymology. It is French from clair, which means clear. Plus voyant. Would that be a Latin word? Maybe. From the verb pouvoir. Is it French? Yes, French. It said French. Pouvoir. Pouar. What does pouar means? To see. So you can see clearly. I can see clearly now. The rain has gone. This is how my brain works. So to see clearly. And that is from the Latin vivere, videre. And there's more at the word wit. Seeing clearly. Hearing clearly. All right. Second form of clairvoyant is a noun from 1846. One having the power of clairvoyance. Again, not me. Okay, next is clam. Or would it be... Yeah, clam. First form, noun from before the 12th century. Synonyms are... Yeah, that's it. Synonyms are clamp and clasp. I just saw so much text in the etymology, I thought it was the actual definition. No. It is from the Old English clam with two M's, which means bond or fetter. Akin to the Old High German clama, which means constriction. And perhaps from the Latin glomus, which means ball. That would be great if all the balls were called glomuses. All right, maybe we should just change English. Let's just change it all right now. All right, second form of clam is a noun from circa 1520. 1A, any of numerous edible marine bivalve mollusks living in sand or mud. So lots of adjectives. 1B, a freshwater mussel. Number 2, a stolid or close-mouthed person. A stolid or stolid? I'm not sure. I think it might be stolid. A stolid or closed-mouthed person is a clam because they ain't talking. They're clammed up. Number 3, synonym is clamshell. 4, it's the number 3 definition for the word dollar. Dollars and clams. That's what the people say, isn't it? So this is from the clamping action of the shells. They clamp down. Third form of clam is a verb from 1636. To gather clams, especially by digging. And clamor is a noun. Let's go clamming. No, let's not do that. So the clams clam up. And they're clammed at that point. All right, next is claimant. C-L-A-M-A-N-T. Clam ant. Haha, that's how it should be spelled. Clam ant. This is an adjective from 1639. 1. Clamorous or blatant. Those are the synonyms. Clamorous and blatant. 2. Demanding attention. Synonym is urgent. And claimantly is an adverb. This is from the Latin verb clamare, which means to cry out. Well, that's funny, because crying out, you are not clamming up when you are crying out. You are doing the opposite. If you were clammed, then you would not be crying out. So clearly, our clam does not come from clamare. All right. Next is clam bake. I've never been to a clam bake, I don't think, and I probably never will. It's a noun from 1835. 1A, an outdoor party, especially a seashore outing where food is usually cooked on heated rocks covered by seaweed. That is a thing that people do. 1B, the food served at a clam bake, and I need a drink of water. Pause. And we're back. If I had a commercial, ooh, maybe I will have a commercial. I'll put it there. Let's see. So we were at clam bake. Number 2, a gathering characterized by noisy sociability, especially a political rally, is a clam bake. Next is clamor or clamber, because that's how it's spelled with a B, clamber. This is a verb from the 14th century, just intransitive, to climb awkwardly, as by scrambling. That is how I would get up something. I would clamber about, as in the example, clambered over the rocks. It is so fun to clamber over the rocks. You might look stupid, but that's okay. Clamberer is a noun. Any other etymology? Climbing. It's from climb, basically. Okay, next is clammy. This is an adjective from the 14th century. 1. Being damp, soft, sticky, and usually cool. Ugh. I don't like to be clammy. This is just not a word that I appreciate. Not that I don't like the word itself, I just don't like to be clammy. As in, cold, clammy hands. Here, let me give you a big handshake with my cold, clammy hands and put my hands on your face. Wouldn't you like that? Nope. Also is in clammy air. Number two, lacking normal human warmth. Ugh. As in the clammy atmosphere of an institution. Let's get some people up in there to warm it up. What would be the opposite of clammy? Maybe I'll look it up in the thesaurus. Clammily is an adverb and clamminess is a noun. Probably from Middle English clammen, which means to smear or stick. From the Old English claig, which means clay. So clay, okay. Next is clamor, C-L-A-M-O. See, that's not how the letters go. C-L-A-M-O-R, noun from the 14th century. 1A, noisy shouting. 1B, a loud, continuous noise. 2, insistent public expression as of support or protest. Get the words out. Clamor. From the Latin clamare, which means to cry out. Ah, that came back. That makes more sense. And there's more at the word claim. Next is the second form of clamor, verb from the 14th century. It is so interesting to just be so focused on little pieces of the English language, just one at a time. All right. Intransitive, to make a din. That was number one. Number one, to make a din. Number two, to become loudly insistent, as in clamored for his impeachment. What did he do? I've got some thoughts. Now, transitive one, to utter or proclaim insistently and noisily. Two, to influence by means of clamor. Third form of clamor, transitive verb from 1611. It is obsolete. Nobody uses this anymore. The synonym is silence. Maybe people stopped using it because it became to mean crying out and making sounds. So, yeah, of course it's not going to mean silence anymore. But back in the day, you'd say clamor and you meant silence. The origin of this is unknown. Next is clamorous, or just clamorous. Adjective from the 15th century. One, marked by confused din or outcry, and a synonym is tumultuous. Number two, means noisily insistent. This is very similar to the previous one. Synonym is the word vociferous. That is such a good word, vociferous. If I were trying to figure out words backwards, I might try that one. Clamorously is an adverb, and clamorousness is a noun. Next is clamor, with an O-U-R, clam hour. Chiefly British variation of clamor without the U, because the Brits like to do that. How many times have I said that statement? A bunch. I'm going to say it a bunch more. Just like all the other things I say. Next is, we have made it to the end. It is our last word. It is clamp. Clamps. What is that guy, clamps, from Futurama?
You think that maybe I should use these clamps that I use every day at every opportunity?
C-L-A-M-P. The first form, noun from the 14th century. One. Oh my god, why do I keep on saying century weird? One. A device designed to bind or constrict or to press two or more parts together so as to hold them firmly. Clamp. Two, any of various instruments or appliances having parts brought together for holding or compressing something. The etymology says from the Old English clam, which means to bond or fetter. And there's more at the word clam. They're clamping. Clams are clamping. We should call them clamps, not clams. I don't know. All right. So I think it is time to reread the words clairvoyance, clairvoyant, clairvoyant, clam, 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 clamant, clam bake, clamber, and clammy, clamor, 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 clamorous, clamor, clamp. That's it. All right. Well, I mean, obviously all these words were incredibly fun, but I think I shall pick clairvoyance as the word of the episode. That also encompasses clairaudience, obviously. It's crazy. All right. Oh, I sort of sang a song. That's fine. Clairvoyance. Clairvoyance. Let's look at the holidays for July 26th. That is the page that we are on. It is Day of National Significance in Barbados, in Cuba. Day of the National Rebellion. It is Esperanto Day. In Liberia, it is Independence Day. It's also Independence Day in the Maldives. In India, it is Kargil Victory Day. Anything on this page? I switched my pages around because this one, it ain't as good as the other one. But sometimes it has something different. And the fun holidays for July 26th. National Aunt and Uncle Day. Thanks, aunts and uncles, for being the ones that are so much cooler than the parents. I can say that because I am an uncle, and my wife is an aunt, and I think we're the best. No, that's all goof. It is also National Coffee Milkshake Day. Coffee milkshake. If you like coffee, you might like that. I'm not the biggest coffee fan. All right, that's it. Thank you very much for listening, and until next time, this is Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the podcast called The Dictionary. So if you would like to review this podcast, this whole show, I would appreciate it if you reviewed it, particularly on Apple Podcasts. It's fairly early. My mouth and my lips and my voice are not warmed up yet. Ooh. All right, now we're good. And then if you want to email me, it's dictionarypod@gmail.com. If you want to follow me on social media and see the pictures and the silly captions I post, that's Twitter and Instagram and Facebook, and at dictionarypod is where you can find that. And I don't think I should make a TikTok, and I have some old... we'll talk about YouTube another time. Once I actually get going in a regular schedule for YouTube, maybe I'll do that. All right. The first word in this episode is clamp, C-L-A-M-P, second form, verb, just transitive from 1683. One, to fasten with or as if with a clamp, as in clamp two boards together. 2A, to place by decree, synonym is impose, and this is often used with the word on, as in clamped on a curfew after the riots. And then 2B, to hold tightly. If you are hugging somebody, you should say, "We're clamping." That's a very odd thing to do, but I think you should do it. Let's clamp. Next is clamp down, noun from 1940, the act or action of making regulations and restrictions more stringent, as in a clampdown on charge accounts, bank loans, and other inflationary influences. That's a quote from Time. Next is clamp down, but this one is two words. The other one was one word. This is an intransitive verb from 1938 to impose restrictions, and the synonym is crack down, two words, as in the police are clamping down on speeders. So you better watch your speed. Next is Clams Casino. Clams Casino, two words, noun from 1908. Clams on the half shell, usually topped with green pepper and baked or broiled. So it's clams cut in half with green pepper. My dad hates green pepper. I feel like most people agree that green peppers are the worst of the peppers, the bell peppers. So who made this up? Why is it? And are they only sold in casinos? What happened here? Often baked or boiled. I honestly don't know if I've ever eaten a clam, and I don't think I will. Same with oysters. Oysters. All right, next is clamshell, noun from circa 1520. One, the shell of a clam. 2A, a bucket or grapple having two hinged jaws. Grapple is like apple with a gur. And the example of that would be on a dredge. Grapple as on a dredge. 2B, an excavating machine having a clam shell. 2C, either of a pair of doors, as in an airplane tail, that open out and away from each other. It's just, it's like French doors. Clamshell doors? 2D, a hinged container, case, or cover that opens like a shell of a clam. There's no etymology for this. Moving on to clam up, two words, intransitive verb from 1916, to become silent, as in clammed up and refused to talk. Next is clam worm, two words, noun from 1885, any of several large burrowing polychaete worms, what is that word, often used as bait. And the example of this worm is a nereid, maybe that's it. But what is this poly word? P-O-L-Y-C-H-A-E-T-E. Polychaete. I don't know. I have to wait till the peas. Yeah. All right. It's a clam worm. But why is it a clam worm? Do they clam up? Do the clams eat them? I don't think the clams would eat them. Maybe they would. I don't know. Possibly. All right. Next is clan. We've finished all the clam worms words. Now we're in the clan words. I suspect we will not be happy at some point here. This is a noun from the 15th century. 1A, a Celtic group, especially in the Scottish Highlands, comprising a number of households whose heads claim descent from a common ancestor. 1B, a group of people tracing descent from a common ancestor, and the synonym is family. We're all a family, we're all a clan. Number 2, a group united by a common interest or common characteristics. This is from Scottish Gaelic, clan with two n's, which means offspring or clan. From the Old Irish, clanned with a d, which means plant or offspring. And then also from the Latin word planta, which means plant. You've planted your kids in the ground. Next we have, okay, you can say this a bunch of different ways. Clandestine, 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 or you can emphasize the first syllable, so it would be clandestine, and then also the different endings. Clandestine, I like to say, what do I like to say? Clandestine, I'll say that. Okay, this is an adjective from circa 1528. Marked by, held in, or conducted with secrecy. And the synonym is surreptitious, as in a clandestine love affair. And then another synonym is the word secret. Clandestinely is an adverb. Clandestineness is a noun. Clandestinity is a noun. And the etymology says, let's see, from the Latin clandestinus, which is from clam or clam, which means secretly. It's akin to the Latin celare, which means to hide, and there's more at the word hell. Yeah. Next is clang, C-L-A-N-G, first form verb from 1576, starting with intransitive. 1A, to make a loud metallic ringing sound, as in anvils clanged. I love it when I accidentally hit something metal and it makes a very cool sound, especially when there's water in it. Like, our cats have little water bowls, and if you're like emptying the water and you hit it right at the beginning and the water's emptying at the same time, it makes a very cool sound. I like the clangs. 1B, to go with a clang. 2, to utter the characteristic harsh cry of a bird. Clang! Now, transitive verb, to cause to clang, as in clang a bell. This is from the Latin clangere, which is akin to the Greek klazine or klazine, which means to scream or bark. From the Old English, hlilhan. I don't know what that means, but that means to laugh, which is what I just did. I hlilhaned. All right, next is the second form of clang, noun from 1557. 1, a loud ringing metallic sound, as in the clang of a fire alarm. Number 2, a harsh cry of a bird, as a crane or goose. The sound of a crane or a goose is called a clang? I mean, it makes sense for a crane to make a clang, maybe, but I never knew that they were called a clang, that harsh cry. Honk. Next is clangor, noun from 1948. It is British, and it means a conspicuous blunder. And this is often used in the phrase, drop a clangor. A conspicuous blunder. That is, seems highly specific. Why can't I say that word? So you blundered, but it was in front of everybody. It wasn't inconspicuous. You blundered big in front of everybody. Sometimes we say it's a party foul, but it's often, drop a clangor. All right, if you are British, can you please email me or send me a message on Twitter or Instagram or a voicemail? There's the voicemail number, Google Voice. You can leave a voicemail. What is drop a clangor? Give me some more context, please. Give me an example. Okay, next is clangor again, but it's spelled with an O-R at the end. This is the first form, noun from 1593. A resounding clang or medley of clangs, as in the clangor of hammers. Clangorous is an adjective, and clangorously is an adverb. Second form of clangor, I can say clangor. This is an intransitive verb from 1837, to make a clangor. Now we have clangor again, but this time it is spelled with an O-U-R at the end. This is the chiefly British variation of clangor with no U. No U, no U. No you, no you, no you, no you. Next is clank. Oh, and I think I gotta sneeze. There we go. Clank, last word. We got two forms in this episode. C-L-A-N-K. First form, verb from 1656, starting with intransitive. One, to make a clank or series of clanks, as in the radiator hissed and clanked. Two, to go with, or as if with, a clank, as in tanks clanking through the streets. Whoa, tanks clanking. I like that sound. Clankin' tanks. Spencer and the clankin' tanks. Now we have transitive, to cause to clank. Clankingly is an adverb. And then the second form of clank, noun from 1656, a sharp, brief, metallic ringing sound. We had so many sound words. So, the words in this episode today were clamp, clamp down, clams casino, clamshell, clamp up, I think I said clamp up, it's clam up, clam worm, clan, clandestine, clang, clangor, 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 clank. Ooh boy, which one do I like? I think I like maybe one of the sound words. Let's take a look at those. Don't think I'm gonna pick those. All right, let's pick clang as the word of the episode. Maybe if I am inspired and motivated to actually record something, I shall record a clang or maybe a clank. Which one will it be? I'm not sure. It depends on what it sounds like, and then also your opinion on what those words actually sound like. Clang, clank? We'll find out. Maybe I'll try both. All right. Clang. We'll see. I'm not going to make a sound a song with a clang. That's just too much work right now. Clang, a clang, 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 clang. In North Korea, it is Day of Victory in the Great Fatherland Liberation War. That's North Korea. The Philippines, Iglesia ni Cristo Day. Puerto Rico, Jose Celso or Kelso Barbosa Day. In Vietnam, Martyrs and Wounded Soldiers Day. And does this page have anything else? Cuba, Revolution Anniversary Celebration. Finland has, National Sleepyhead Day. It's also called Seven Sleepers Day. I want to know where that came from. It's also National New Jersey Day. Yay, New Jersey. Fun holiday times. It's National Creme Brulee Day and also National Scotch Day. I don't even remember the last time I had a creme brulee, and I'm sure I've had scotch, but it's not a thing I drink very often, so would they go well together? If you're an expert on both of these, scotch and creme brulee, do they go well together? I'm not so sure about that, but maybe we can make that happen. Maybe we can have a scotch-flavored creme brulee. All right. I think that's the end of the episode. It's also the end of page 227. Thank you very much for listening, and until next time, this is Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye. Hello, word nerds. Welcome to the dictionary. Ooh, maybe we're all warmed up now. We are at the top of page 228. My voice can get all high like this if I want to talk, but no, sometimes I want to talk low like this. What happens? We end up right in the middle somewhere. The first word in this episode, top of page 228, I think I already said that, it is the word clannish, C-L-A-N-N-I-S-H. Adjective from 1776, one of or relating to a clan, as in clannish traditions. Two, tending to associate only with a select group or similar background, obviously I should have seen that, or status, as in a clannish community. Clannishly is an adverb, and clannishness is a noun. Next is clansman. M-A-N at the end. Clansman. Noun from 1810. A member of a clan. See, it doesn't have to be that clansman. It's just, you know, different things are called clans. There's one clan that we think of that we don't want to talk about, but we have to talk about sometime. And that is also a clansman, but, you know, you can just be part of a clan, a group. That's totally cool. And that would be a clansman, although there probably should be clanswoman, right? I don't think that's in here. Nope, because the next word is clap. Wow, I think I got real loud there. Clap. First form, verb from the 14th century. One, to strike. To strike together so as to produce a sharp percussive noise. Man, we had a lot of these noise words. Clap, clank, clang. Why are they all spelled so similarly? And then the example of what you are striking is two flat, hard surfaces. Or they could be two somewhat flat, fleshy surfaces, like your hands. Okay, 2A. To strike the hands together repeatedly, usually in applause. And then 2B, the synonym is applaud. 3, to strike with the flat of the hand in a friendly way, as in, clapped his friend on the shoulder. 4, to place, put, or set especially energetically. Huh? To place, put, or set especially energetically, as in, clap, what word are we on? Clap him into jail. Also as in, since I first clapped eyes on it. Has anybody used this in real life? I don't know. 5, to improvise or build hastily, as in a hut clapped together from old plywood. So, those were all transitive. Now is intransitive time. 1, to produce a percussive sound, especially the synonym slam. 2, to go abruptly or briskly. And 3, the synonym is again applaud. This is from Middle English, clappen, from Old English, kleipen. Maybe they just said clappen because it has the AE symbol. That means to throb. Like maybe if you're clapping so hard, your hands start to throb. It is akin to the Old High German klafon, which means to beat. And now we learn something. Second form of clap, noun from the 13th century, 1. A device that makes a clapping noise. What sort of device would that be? 2 is obsolete. A sudden stroke of fortune and especially ill fortune. 3, a loud percussive noise, specifically a sudden crash of thunder. Crash, there's another one. 4A, a sudden blow. 4B, a friendly slap, as in a clap on the back. All these words that are so similar. Clap, slap, back is not, but I want to say black. A clap on the back. 5, the sound of clapping hands, especially the synonym applause. Yes, it is the sound, but the people who are hard of hearing, they don't clap because it makes a sound and they can't hear it. So instead, what they do is they put their hands up by their heads and they wiggle them back and forth. Maybe wiggle isn't the right word. But you know, you've maybe you've seen it. That's how they applaud. because it is way more visual. Can you imagine putting on a show and looking out in the theater and seeing just the entire audience doing that motion? I mean, it's probably, you know, the applause that we think of now, seeing everybody clap, that already must be very visually interesting. But then to see everybody with their hands up by their heads, waving them back and forth like that, they're just twisting their, you know, their forearm back and forth. That must be quite a sight to see a whole group of people doing that. Where were we? All right. Third form of clap. It is a noun from 1587. The synonym is gonorrhea. And I shall spell that for you. G-O-N-O-R-R-H-E-A. Gonorrhea. It's spelled similarly confusingly like the word diarrhea. This is often used with the word the clap. You don't want the clap. This is from Middle French, clapoir, which means bubo. What is bubo? I don't remember. B-U-B-O. All right, next we have clapboard. Clapboard, one word. You could say clabbered, clabbered, clapboard, probably something else. This is a noun from circa 1520. One is archaic. A size of board for making staves and wainscoting. Two, a narrow board, usually thicker at one edge than the other, used for siding. Three, this would be definitely pronounced clapboard, a pair of hinged boards, one of which has a slate with data identifying a piece of film and which are banged together in front of a motion picture camera at the start of a take to facilitate editing, called also clapper board. I use these almost every time I go on a video shoot for work. I use one of these, and they're great, because I also do editing, and it has come in very handy. You gotta write the information on the front. Right now, they got... Right now. It's just right now. Later, they won't, but right now, they have digital clapboards. And, you know, that has other benefits. I've never used one of those, because I'm not fancy. But, yeah. You clap it down so it has a very quick sound, and you can use that visually and aurally for syncing things up. And then clapboard is also a transitive verb. I like being the person who does the clapper. Let's see. This is part trans something. I don't know what that means. Of, I believe, Dutch klafout. Klafout? Klapout? That is stave wood. So stave wood is from a Dutch word. I should probably confirm that D is Dutch. I don't know why it wouldn't be. Yes, it is. So that's where it comes from. All right, next is clapped out. Two words with a hyphen. Adjective from 1946. It is chiefly British, and the synonym is worn out. Two words with a hyphen. Also the synonym, tired. I'm so clapped out. Next is clapper. Noun from the 14th century. One that claps. As A, the tongue of a bell. It is clapping against the insides of a bell. It's the clapper. And then B, a mechanical... And there's also a C, stupid. B, a mechanical device that makes noise, especially by the banging of one part against another. And then C, a person who applauds. They are the clapper. Clapper claw is next. One word. Transitive verb from 1591. It's English dialect. To claw with the nails. Clapper claw. Clapper claw? Claw with the nails? They call that clapper claw? And then number two is also English dialect. The synonyms are scold and I guess it would be revile, but you could say revel, but I think it's revile. And the etymology just says it's perhaps from clapper plus claw, which is kind of obvious, right? The verb of claw, clapper, claw, I don't know. All right, next is clapper rail. Rail, R-A-I-L. This is two words. Noun from 1813. A grayish-brown, long-billed American rail that inhabits coastal marshes. What is a rail? I'm going to assume it's a bird, but it might not be. The scientific name is Rallus longirostris. Longirostris. And then the name is from its rattle-like call, clapper rail. But the word rattle isn't in there. It's clapper. It's a rail. Maybe we should post a picture so I can actually go find out what this is. Clapper, rail. Could be so many things. So many living creatures live in the marshes. What is it? The only two I can think of could possibly be a snake, maybe? I don't know. All right, next we have claptrap. Claptrap. One word, first form, noun from 1799. Pretentious nonsense. Synonym is trash. Oh, that is such claptrap. I like this word. This is from the second form of clap, from its attempt to win applause. It's a trap to get some claps. Pretentious nonsense. All right. I can't think of an example at the moment, but when I come across some pretentious nonsense, I will know and I will call it. That is claptrap. Second form of claptrap is an adjective from 1815, characterized by or suggestive of claptrap, especially of a cheap, showy nature, as in claptrap sentiment. Next is clacker. This is spelled the French way, C-L-A-Q-U-E-U-R, clacker. Actually, it would be pronounced claqueur. That makes much more sense, claqueur. Although the French probably would say claqueur. Noun from 1837, a member of a claque. Well, oh, did I skip that? Oh, stupid Spencer, you skipped claque. Let's read claque. C-L-A-Q-U-E. Noun from 1848. One, a group hired to applaud at a performance. What? This is a thing? People get hired to applaud? I guess I shouldn't be that surprised. Number two, a group of sycophants. It's a great word. I've heard it. I can't remember what it means, but a group of them is a claque. This is from the French claqueur, which means to clap. So maybe now we should read claqueur. It's a member of a claque. If you are a claque, in a claque, you are a claqueur. And then this is, yes, again, from the French claqueur, which means to clap. What? Why do groups get hired to applaud? I guess if you're not hiring a lot of tickets, not, man, you gotta slow down. If you're not selling a lot of tickets, but you want the people to come in and have the other people think that it's better than it really is, if you got a show or something, then you hire a claque to applaud. Obviously, they did this in France, because that's where the name comes from. Hey, let's talk about the last word. It is claret. Claret. C-L-A-R-E-T. Claret. Noun from 1578. One, a red Bordeaux wine. Also, a similar wine produced elsewhere. And then number two, a dark purplish red. Claret is also an adjective. This is from Anglo-French claret, which means clear wine. See, that doesn't make any sense, because it is clearly not a clear wine. Clearly. It's a dark purplish red wine. But it's from claret, which means wine, from clair, which means clear. Again, why? It's a red wine. Why would you name it claret? That doesn't make any sense. I don't like this. I don't like this one bit. Okay, so the words today were clannish, clansman, clap, clapboard, clapped out, clapper, clapper claw, clapper rail, claptrap, clack, clacker, claret. Well, I like clapboard because I use those. I also like claptrap because that was funny. I like the idea of that. I'll pick clapboard as the word of the episode because, I don't know, we usually just call them clappers. There's another name that I cannot think of at the moment. Why can I not think of it? Anyway, I'll think of it later. Clapboard. You're filming some stuff with multi-cameras and audio, and you need a clapboard to sync them all up and also say what the information is, like what take number you're on. Yeah. Yep. All right. The holidays today, July 28th. That is where we are. In Canada, it is Day of Commemoration of the Great Upheaval. Upheaval. Had a little burp hiccup thing. What is the great upheaval? I could click on the link and find out, but I'm not going to right now. In Bermuda, it is the earliest day on which Emancipation Day can fall in where? Okay, so this is Fiestas Patrias. That is the independence of Peru from Spain in 1821. In San Marino, it is Liberation Day. In the Faroe Islands, it is Olav Saka Eve. It is World Hepatitis Day. So be aware of that and try not to get the hepatitis. In Ukraine, it is Baptism of Kvion Rus. In Chile, it is Indigenous Day. And the fun holidays, at least here in America, are, well, World Hepatitis Day is listed. It's not, this website is not fun holidays. That's just what I say, because usually they're more fun. But World Hepatitis Day, that's not a fun holiday. Relatedly, it's not a fun holiday, but it is a very good thing to celebrate. It is Buffalo Soldiers Day. Maybe I should put a clip. I probably already did that, but that's okay. I can do it again. Let's put in a clip of Bob Marley's Buffalo Soldier. Buffalo Soldier, dreadlock Rasta. It was a Buffalo Soldier in the heart of America. And I'm trying to think of why or read this a little bit. Dude, anyway, it's Buffalo Soldier Day. Go learn about them if you don't know about them. And then finally, it is National Milk Chocolate Day. Milk Chocolate Day. Okay, so yeah, I was thinking chocolate milk, but no, this is just all milk chocolate. I used to eat milk chocolate exclusively. I'm not a fan of the dark chocolate because I don't care for the bitter. I like the sweet. And milk chocolate is sweeter. But then when I went vegan, I had to get rid of all the milk chocolate. Well, I mean, I finished it up, and then I was fully vegan. But I have not had milk chocolate since. Although, there are some companies that are now making vegan milk chocolate, which honestly isn't that hard. You know, we've got all these dairy-free milks. Why not put them in some chocolate so you can have some sweeter chocolate? That's what I like. If any of those companies would like to send me some, I would accept. Just saying. But yeah, otherwise I eat dark chocolate. It can't be too dark. Oh, you know what? That's the end. We have reached our time. I will see you next week. No, I'll see you tomorrow. I'll hear you tomorrow. You'll hear me tomorrow. Thank you very much for listening. And until next time, this is Spencer Dispensing Information. Goodbye.